Welcome, I'm Ijeoma Onyaso. Tonight, Supreme Court affirms the election of Nyesom Wike, Ibukunle Amosu, and Dave Umahi as governors of Rivers, Ogun, and Ebonyi states. Yahaya Bello takes the reins as governor of Kogi State amid excitement in Lokoja. Deputy Governor-elect James Faleke absent at ceremony. President Buhari writes National Assembly requests for stiffer laws to punish culprits of corruption in Nigeria. And the European Union threatens Greece over failure to tighten border control to limit influx of migrants.
On business news tonight, Nigeria's Minister of Finance, Mrs. Kemi Adeosun, seeks policy convergence for sustainable economic growth.
And on sports news tonight, Liverpool ladies accept Arsenal's bid for Super Falcons striker Azizat Oshoala.
And from Abuja, I'm Yemisi Ipaye. Tonight, reprieve for National Publicity Secretary Olisa Metu as court varies his bail conditions.
We begin in the nation's capital, Abuja, where the Supreme Court today affirmed the victory of Mr. Nyesom Wike, Ibukunle Amosu, and Dave Umahi as governors of Rivers, Ogun, and Ebonyi states, respectively, in the 2015 governorship election. In a lead judgment delivered by Justice Kudirat Kekereekun, the apex court overturned the judgment of the appeal court, which upheld the nullification of Mr. Wike's election by the Elections Petitions Tribunal. The apex court also ruled that Mr. Amosu and Mr. Umahi were duly elected as the chief executive officers of Ogun and Ebonyi states. And now we'll have more on all that transpired today later on in the bulletin. But Lokoja, the Kogi State capital, came alive today as Mr. Yahaya Bello took office, and that was his oath of office, as the fourth governor of the state. In an emotion-laden speech, Governor Bello paid glowing tribute to the former APC candidate, late Prince Abubakar Audu. He also urged all those who have grievances to sheathe their swords and work for the development of the state. He was sworn in spite of several lawsuits challenging his election.
There are some of the early callers at the venue of the inauguration, and the sort of energy they display perhaps shows the excitement this brings for the thousands of people who've trooped out to witness this occasion. Loads of controversy trail the emergence of Mr. Yahaya Bello, but it appears a turn of events is shaping up the outlook of the entire matter.
A minority in Kogi State is the governor of Kogi State. Can we all say glory be to God? The Muslim, can you shout Allahu Akbar?
For the APC, it is a big achievement as another state is added to the states they control.
Today is God's own doing. We have no choice in these things but to accept the will of the Almighty.
I, Yahaya Bello.
The moment comes when Mr. Yahaya Bello transforms from a governor-elect into a substantive governor. And what makes that magic is this.
I will discharge my duties to the best of my ability, faithfully, and in accordance with the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
The swearing-in and oath-taking completes the ritual. Jubilations and excitement rent the air. The new governor parades the arena in a motorcade. March pass and all is set for the inaugural speech. A very emotional Governor Bello is thankful to those who he says has made the dream of becoming a governor a reality, including his late father.
I am equally grateful to Alhaji Bello Ipemida Ochi, my father, whose evergreen memories and legacies remain till today, despite his death early in my life. Haji Ahawa Bello, your hand rocked my cradle, and you still might rock my world. Despite the anguish of your widowhood, your values steadied me through the turbulence of youth and years of my self-discovery.
Business unusual is what the governor is promising, and the affairs of Kogi State change, he says, has come.
This quote is a complete worldview which defines the purpose and methodology of my administration and sets agenda of inclusiveness, which I am determined which will characterize my tenure. My administration shall exist for the sole purpose of serving the superseding interests of people of Kogi State to the very best of its capability.
A new dawn for the North Central State of Kogi as it gets a new leader amidst myriad of economic and political upheavals. How Governor Bello hopes to better the lives of his people is what we all must wait to find out. Shewa Kimbale, Channels Television News.
In the meantime, the deputy governorship candidate to late Prince Abubakar Audu during the November 21st, 2015 governorship election in Kogi State, Mr. James Faleke, has vowed to intensify legal proceedings against the election of Yahaya Bello as the Kogi State governor. Addressing his supporters in Abuja, Mr. Faleke explained that he did not institute any legal proceedings against the swearing-in of Governor Bello because he's confident the judiciary will nullify his election. Mr. Faleke claims that the All Progressives Congress leadership did not make any effort to broker peace between him and Governor Bello.
Today, the governor has been sworn in, and we have no objection to that, for him being sworn in today. And that is why we didn't go to court. We never joined PDP or Labour to stop his swearing in. No. Because we know that at the appointed time, he will be sent out. I expected the party to have even brought us together to say, two of you, let us talk. Even before the announcement to the to the general public, it wasn't done. The chairman of our party cannot look into my eyes and said that he, Excellency George Odigeoyemu, called me. He can't. He's an elderly man. But he cannot lie in my presence.
Let's stay with our lead story on the swearing-in of a new governor in Kogi State, Yahaya Bello. Well, that took place earlier today, and he promised to be a leader for all the indigens of Kogi State. Could there be constitutional issues? Joining me to take a look at that is a lecturer in the Faculty of Law in the University of Lagos, Dr. Yemi Oke. Thank you so much for joining us on the news at 10 tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Well, Dr. Bello was alone there on the podium. We know what the Constitution says about the joint ticket. Definitely. Is everything okay in terms of the Constitution legally?
Well, as far as the swearing in of today is concerned, it has created a kind of anomaly that is not within the contemplation even of the Constitution because of the death of Prince Audu. It's very clear under Section 187, 1 and 2, the nomination of a governorship candidate is and can never be valid unless and until a running mate is nominated to run with him. Faleke withdrew his consent. He clearly indicated his objection not to run with him. So Faleke technically was not the running mate of the now governor Bello. Whatever happens in that election, two things. If the nomination of Bello is invalid by reason as provided in the constitution of non-nomination, valid nomination of a deputy governor, the law is clear. It's not something, it's not a factual thing, it's a constitutional provision. That election might not stand. Mm. And my worry is that, of course, the former governor now, being the runner-up in the election, might inherit the entire thing because there is still an argument as to whether, as at the time of the election, whether the election was conclusive or inconclusive. That argument is still there because inconclusive the inconclusiveness of the election had to do with the fact that the number of registered voters as against the number of voters that collected their PVCs. That argument is still in court.
I was going to say that as well, that there's no shortage of litigation in this particular matter.
We're going to have a lot of such.
How do you see it playing out for him? Do you see his election being upturned? What kind of right is he going to have?
Well, speaking as a lawyer and as a teacher of the law, and what my constitution says, and what I read in the constitution that is not in any way ambiguous, that is very clear, Section 187(1) says the election, the nomination of a governorship candidate shall not be valid at all until he has nominated a running mate. And the election, one of the grounds of nullification of an election is qualification and validity of nomination. If you've not been validly nominated, you cannot be validly elected, and you cannot be legally or validly sworn in. So it's just a matter of time. It's a difficult hurdle before him. I wish him the very best. I wish the people of Kogi State the very best.
Okay, let's then,
It's tough. It's a tough one.
Talking about hurdles, let's switch over to River State and see what's happening there in terms of the Supreme Court affirming Governor Wike. Did that surprise you at all?
I wasn't really surprised, reason because we're all apprehensive. Apprehensive in the sense that, unlike criminal litigation, civil cases, including election petitions, are decided based on preponderance of evidence. Whichever one outweighs the other slightly, and the balance of convenience is in favor of Governor Wike. Unless and until the accuser, now the APC candidate, has been able to prove beyond all reasonable doubt that the election was rigged or that no election took place, the same election was the election that got some people elected or voted as of assembly members. If the court oppose the validity of members of the House of Assembly, then the question is, could it be that no election held for the governor at all, or that certain polling booths are questionable? In which case, is it that we'll go and, of course, invalidate elections in specific areas as against invalidating the entire election? I'm sure the court wasn't that convinced, because the late judgment given by Justice Kekereku appeared before, I even read from the High Court in Lagos. It's a no-nonsense judge. The panel, I don't have the full list yet, but Supreme Court is not a court for somebody who's not convinced of his law or facts. So I'm sure the Supreme Court must have arrived at that decision based on sound reasoning and the position of the law. And until February 12th, when we're going to have the position of the law of the court stated in details, then the law is law. It's not only a judgment for the parties. Once the Supreme Court gives judgment, it becomes law, even for litigants, the binding precedent for lower courts and parties. That's the law for now. I can also wish them the very best in River State.
Indeed, Dr. Yemi Oke, thank you so much for joining us on the news at 10 tonight. And in part two, after the break, 14 people killed in a suicide attack in Chibok, Borno State. That's in a moment. To join us again.